Now we will start some questions. The first question is, which of the following era in the geological time scale corresponds to the period when life was not originated on earth? Note these questions also. The first question, which of the following era in geological time scale corresponds to the period when there was no when life was not originated on earth? The options are Azoic era, second Mesozoic era, third Paleozoic era, and fourth Archaeozoic era. We have studied earlier that the Azoic era, the answer will be Azoic era. In the Azoic era, there was no life, and it was the only era when the it was the era when only the earth has been originated at this time. And the Mesozoic era, this will not be the answer. Why? Because Mesozoic era was the age of reptiles. At this time, the reptiles were at their dominance. And the Paleozoic era, this is the third era. At this time, the plants and animals were equally originating. And in the Paleozoic era, there were the age of bryophytes and the golden age of fishes. And the Archaeozoic era, this was the second era. This is also called as the dawn of early or the era of dawn of life. The second question is, Cro-Magnon man was frugivorous, carnivorous, herbivorous, or omnivorous? So, Cro-Magnon men were carnivorous because they used to do hunting, and as they were doing hunting, so they cannot be frugivorous or they cannot be the herbivorous. They have to be the carnivorous. And frugivorous were other one, that is some of the Australopithecus efferensis were frugivorous, and some of the Homo erectus were also frugivorous, and the Cro-Magnon man was the carnivorous. Third one, synthesis of amino acids. Here we are doing the common questions from every topic. After that we will do the topic wise questions. The synthesis of amino acids to prove that amino acids were formed in the primitive ocean was experimentally proved by, meaning synthesis of amino acids to prove that the amino acids were formed in the primitive oceans. Primitive oceans mein amino acids bane the, and uska evolutionary experiment. This was given by, or this was proved by, the four options are Sidney Fox, Oparin, Heldin, and Stanley Miller and Urey. So the first option, when we take our first option, the Sidney Fox, it cannot be the answer because Sidney Fox had discovered the microspheres. The second one, Oparin. No, because Oparin has proposed the modern theory or the chemical theory of the evolution. The Heldin, he is also involved along with the Oparin for the he also proposed the modern theory. Both Oparin and Heldin collectively proposed the modern theory. The fourth option is the Stanley Miller and Urey. So Stanley Miller and Urey performed that experiment, which is also known as the simulation experiment. And in that experiment, they had made the conditions similar to that of the primitive environment. Like in the primitive environment, there was no oxygen. So they had had apparatus of the vacuum in their whole experimental apparatus. They had a vacuum pump. And for the source of energy in the primitive environment, the electric current was, or the lightning we can say, this was the source of energy. And in the simulation experiment, Miller and Urey has used the electric spark for the source of energy. And in the primitive environment, the temperature was so high, and in the apparatus they had maintained the temperature up to 800 degrees Celsius by passing the electric current between the two electrodes. So this is how they maintained the primitive conditions of the primitive conditions in their apparatus, and they also formed the some of the compounds. What were the compounds? Amino acids, some more other organic acids, and like aldehydes, ketones, they were formed, and some nucleic acids were also formed along with that. So these were some acids, or these were some products that have been formed in the primitive atmosphere also. And when the Miller and Urey, they formed the similar apparatus as that of the which were same in the conditions of what were the conditions in the primitive atmosphere, they had maintained such conditions in their apparatus also, and they formed the amino acids. The fourth one, dinosaurs become extinct in. The four options are Permian period, Triassic period, Cretaceous period, and Jurassic period. So, I tell you one thing, that MCQs करने के लिए हमको choosing method apply नहीं करना चाहिए. We should not choose the first answer. We should eliminate first the answers. Like this. The question is, dinosaurs become extinct in. So the first option is Permian period. So याद करो कि Permian period में क्या हुआ था. Permian period belonging to the Paleocene era. It is the last period. And in the Permian period, the reptiles were started to arise. Reptiles were not dominant. In the Permian period, they started to arise. So ये answer नहीं हो सकता. Triassic period. Triassic period में dinosaurs थे, they were at their abundant, not they were dominant also. Dinosaurs were there at the abundant, giant reptiles were started to form and dinosaurs were at their abundant. And the third, the Cretaceous period, this can be the answer. Cretaceous period of the Mesozoic era, it is the time of the extinction of the giant reptiles. And the fourth one, Jurassic period. ये भी नहीं हो सकता, because Jurassic period is the period of dominance of the dinosaurs. So the answer will be the Cretaceous period. Now the fifth one, reduced nictitating membrane is the example of. The first option is analogous organ, second option homologous organ, third option vestigial organ, and the fourth option essential organ. So now eliminate one by one. Analogous organs हो नहीं सकता. क्यों नहीं हो सकता? क्योंकि comparison में दूसरा organ तो दिया ही नहीं हुआ है. Single organ has given nictitating membrane. So nictitating membrane could not be the analogous organ. Homologous organ, the same reason, it cannot be the homologous organ. Vestigial organ, it can be vestigial organ. Essential organ, no. Why? Because it is not present in our body. अब हमारी body में ये present ही नहीं है, तो फिर ये essential organ कैसे हो गया? So it cannot be the essential organ also. So the answer will be the vestigial organ. Vestigial organ is the nictitating membrane is the vestigial organ. It is present here. Suppose this is the structure of the eye. So the pink colored part which is present here is the nictitating membrane, and it is working in the fishes. It is highly developed in the fishes, the nictitating membrane, or in the aquatic mammals, aquatic organisms. So when the organisms are in the water, this type of covering is made over their eyes. Ek type ki covering unki eyes par aa jati hai. So the water could not enter into their eyes, and this covering is transparent, so they could see. They have the proper vision. So the vestigial organ is nictitating membrane in human body. The next question, which of the following is related with the reproductive isolation? The first one, temporal isolation, the genetic isolation, behavior isolation, or all the above. So, reproductive isolation, we have studied the reproductive isolation, that it is the mechanism to prevent the organisms of two different species from the interbreeding to maintain their dignity, and it is also the source of evolution, because when the two different organisms of the two different species, when they will interbreed, then there are the more chances of evolution, then there are the more chances of genetic variability. So, reproductive isolation is favorable also and reproductive isolation is unfavorable also. Favorable is tarah se hua kyunki jab reproductive isolation hoga, means that jab two different species, when they will mate with each other, when they will interbreed with each other. So, jab interbreeding karenge, then there are the chances of some type of genetic variability. There are some chances of mutation. So, by this mutation or by this genetic variability, there is the chance of getting evolved. There is a chance of evolution. So, we can say that this reproductive isolation is also the raw material for the evolution. And we have also studied that reproductive isolation are of two types, the prezygotic and the postzygotic. These we have the options that we have read here, that is temporal isolation, genetic isolation and behavioral isolation. These are the prezygotic type of reproductive isolation. What we have studied in the temporal isolation, it is according to the season, that sometimes seasons may be the factor for not mating of the two different species or for not mating of the two individuals of the same species also, when they are belonging to the different climatic conditions. So, temporal means seasonal variations. So, when there is a seasonal variations at one place there is the summer and at another place there is the winter, and the summer is the season when their gametes are totally developed. So, they cannot mate or they cannot interbreed. And genetic isolations, this can be also the one factor for the reproductive isolation which prevents the two animals from interbreeding. And the behavioral isolation, this also can be the reason. Why? Because many of the different organisms have their different mating characteristics or they have their different courtship characteristics. So, sometimes these are also the problems for mating. So, this can be also one prezygotic type of reproductive isolation. So, the answer of which of the following is related with the reproductive isolation will be all of the above. Temporal isolation is the is also related to reproductive isolation, genetic and behavioral, all the three are related to the reproductive isolation. The next question is abiogenesis meaning. Abiogenesis meaning spontaneous generation or the origin of life from one from living organisms. The third one, origin of life from non-living organisms. Or the fourth one, origin of life from microbes. We have studied that in abiogenetic theory of origin of life. It states that the life has been originating spontaneously from the non-living material. Life non-living material se evolve hoti hai according to the abiogenesis theory. So, the spontaneous generation, no. The second one, origin of life from living organisms, no, because it is abiogenesis theory. It only states that the life has been originating from the non-living materials. The third one, origin of life from non-living matter, it could be the answer and it is the correct answer. We will check the fourth option also, the origin of life from microbes, it cannot be the answer. So, the third one, that is origin of life from non-living organisms, it will be the correct answer. Now, the next question, more cranial cavity will be of first one Peking man, second one Java ape man, third one Cro-Magnon man and the fourth one Neanderthal man. So, the answer will be Cro-Magnon man, because it is the last one to get evolved in the human evolution. It belongs to the Homo sapiens. And the pecking man, it belongs to Homo erectus. Java ape man, it also belongs to Homo erectus. And Neanderthal man, it belongs to the Homo sapiens, but its cranial cavity is not higher than the Cro-Magnon man. The cranial cavity of Cro-Magnon man is highest among all of the organisms which has been evolved during the lineage of human evolution. Now, the next question, Cenozoic era is the era of age of fishes, age of reptiles, age of mammals and age of amphibians. So, the Cenozoic era, let's see the first option, the age of fishes, no, because age of fishes is the Devonian period of the Paleozoic era. The age of fishes, we have studied that the golden age of fishes belongs to the Devonian period of the Paleozoic era, and it is also the same one when the fishes get diversified. Different forms of the fishes were formed, like the sharks and also the lung fishes were also formed, and many other different diversified forms of fishes were formed in the age of fishes, that is Devonian period of the Paleozoic era. The second one, age of reptiles, no, it could not be, the Cenozoic era is not the age of reptiles, because the age of reptiles is Jurassic period belonging to the Mesozoic era. Third, age of mammals, yes, it could be the answer, because the Cenozoic era is the last era. The Cenozoic era is the last era and it is the age of mammals. The fourth one, age of amphibians, no, it could not be the age of amphibians, because the age of amphibians is Paleozoic era. Next question, trilobites were evolved during which period? The options are Silurian, second Cambrian, third Ordovician and fourth Precambrian. So, the answer is Silurian period. Trilobites have been evolved during the Silurian period. Now, the next one, highest cranial cavity will be of the first one, Java ape man, second one, pecking man, third one, handyman, fourth one, modern man. This is the variation of the one question that we have studied earlier, increased cranial cavity. The same options were there, but one option was the Cro-Magnon man, and here the one option is modern man. So what will be the answer? Modern man. Why others could not be the answer? The first was Java ape man, it was belonging to the Homo erectus. The second was pecking man, it was also belonging to the Homo erectus. The third one, handyman or the tool maker, it was also belonging to the Homo erectus. The fourth one, modern man, it is the only one that is belonging to the Homo sapiens. So, its cranial cavity will be higher than the other animals. Next question, which of the following formed in the Miller-Urey experiment? So, the options are amino acids, second one nucleic acid, third one UV radiations and fourth one microspheres. So, the answer will be amino acids. Amino acids were formed in the Miller-Urey experiment. Now, the next question, human ancestors who left cave paintings. कौन से human ancestors ने caves में painting बना के छोड़ के गए थे? So the answers, options are Neanderthal man, second Cro-Magnon man, third Java ape man, fourth pecking man. So the answer will be Cro-Magnon man. Neanderthal man were the men who were first civilized. Java ape man were not so civilized and they were belonging to the Homo erectus. At that time there was no culture, no civilization. they were only hunters and they used to make the some hunting equipments and some tools. Packing men, they were also used to make tools and some hunting equipments. So the remaining one, that is Cro-Magnon men, these were the only organisms which used to make the cave paintings. Which of the following provides most evident proof of evolution? The first one, fossils. Second one, morphology. Third one, embryology. And the fourth one, vestigial organs. The question was, which of the following provide most evident proof of evolution? So the fossils, they give the proof of evolution, but they don't show any link from the ancestors. They don't show any type of link that we have been evolved from the common type of ancestors, or all the animals have been evolved from the common type of ancestors. They don't show the lineage of the evolution. So the fossils could not be the answer. Second, morphology, no, because morphology don't show the link between the ancestors and the today's man. Embryology, no. And the last one, that is vestigial organ. This will be the answer, because vestigial organs shows that there is some connection between the ancestors and between the present man. That is the presence of the vermiform appendix. Vermiform appendix is the ruminant of the cecum, which was functional in our ancestors because they were herbivorous. They used to have their food in the form of leaves. So in their body, the cecum was to digest that leaves. In our body, we used to eat only the roasted food. We used to eat that paka hua khana. So in our body, there is no need of the vermiform appendix, but it is present. There is no need of the cecum, but the ruminant of the cecum is vermiform appendix. So it is present in our body. This shows that we have been evolved from the common type of ancestors. Now the next question, life originated in. Options are air, soil, mountain or water. It is a very direct question. Life originated in water. Atmosphere of Earth. Next question. The atmosphere of Earth just before the origin of life consisted of. The first option is water vapor, methane, ammonia and oxygen. It could not be the answer because yahan pe oxygen aaya hai option mein. Primitive environment mein to oxygen tha hi nahi. Therefore, because of the absence of oxygen, the primitive environment was called as reducing type of environment. Now, the second one, carbon dioxide, ammonia and CH4. Carbon dioxide was not present in the primitive environment. The third one, methane, that is CH4, ammonia, hydrogen and water vapor. So this could be the answer. Let's check the another option. Methane, ozone, oxygen and water vapor. This could not be the answer because in the question it is asking that atmosphere of the earth just before the origin of life. So there was no oxygen and no ozone. So the answer will be the third one. What was the third option? Methane, ammonia, hydrogen and water vapor. This was the third option. And the third option is correct. The fourth one, which was absent in the atmosphere at the time of origin of life. This is very important question and it has been asked in many a times in the exams. It has been also asked in AIIMS, NEET and some other exams like BHU, MHU, BHU, MKU. So this is the important question. The question is, which was absent in the atmosphere at the time of origin of life? The options are ammonia, hydrogen, oxygen and methane. So directly oxygen will be the answer. That was absent in the primitive environment, and because of its absence, primitive environment is called a primitive environment was reducing in nature. Now the next question, English scientist who worked on origin of life and settled in India. The options are Oparin, second one Archbishop Usher, the third one Louis Pasteur, and the fourth one Haldane. We have earlier discussed that the two scientists, Oparin and Haldane, they had proposed the modern theory of the evolution, or the naturalistic theory. It is also called as naturalistic theory of the evolution. And Oparin was belonging to Russia and Haldane was belonging to England, who later on got shifted to the India, to Bhuvaneshwar, belonging to the state Orissa. So Haldane will be the answer, who worked on the origin of life and later on settled in India in Bhuvaneshwar, belonging to the state Orissa. Now the next question: gaseous mixture used by Miller and Urey for the synthesis of amino acids through heat and electric discharge included methane, ammonia, nitrogen, water vapor. No, this will not be the answer, because nitrogen was not there at that time in the environment. So Miller and Urey, they also did not use the nitrogen for their experiment. The next option: methane, nitrogen, water vapor and hydrogen. No, it could not be the answer, because again nitrogen is present in this option. The next option: ammonia, carbon dioxide, nitrogen and water vapor. Nitrogen and carbon dioxide, they were not present in the primitive environment, and Miller and Urey, they also did not use both of these gases in their environment. The last option: methane, ammonia, hydrogen and water vapor. This is the answer. We have also studied that VAM, to remember the gases which Miller and Urey, they both have used in their simulation experiment, that water vapor, ammonia and methane. They had used this in the ratio of 2:1:2, and along with this hydrogen. Hydrogen was also present, and the ratio of these three gases are 2:1:2, and the gases were water vapor, ammonia and methane. They had used these three gases in their simulation experiment. Now the next question: spontaneous generation theory of origin of life was disproved through experiments involving swan neck flask was given by. Question is, spontaneous generation theory. Spontaneous generation theory means abiogenesis theory of origin of life was disproved through experiment involving swan neck flask. So the options are von Helmont. No, he discovered the he has given the example for the abiogenesis theory. He has given the evidence for the favorism of the abiogenesis theory. Von Helmont, what was his example? He done an experiment personally, that he has taken up his sweat soaked shirt, and along with the sweat soaked shirt he has kept some wheat grains, and he kept that for some days. And after some days, when he observed that there was the life of mice, or they were the mice roaming around the shirt, so he observed that. So he concluded that when we keep the sweat soaked shirt along with the wheat grains, then it will give rise to the mice. So this was not correct, because it could be possible that mice are attracted towards the shirt or towards the wheat grains. So this was not correct, and the example of von Helmont was discarded. So von Helmont was the favorer of the abiogenesis theory. So this could not be the answer. Second one, Reddy, Francisco Reddy. He has given the evidence in the favor in the against of the abiogenesis theory, but he has not used the swan neck flask in his experiment. He has just used the glass flask, and he has taken three glass flasks and they filled with the nutrient medium. What nutrient medium he was taking? The boiled meat broth. And he kept one jar open, and the second and third jar he covered with the parchment membrane and by the muslin cloth. So he has not given the experiment with the swan neck flask. His flask were the normal round bottom flask. Louis Pasteur? Yes. Louis Pasteur has done the experiment in the against of the abiogenesis theory, and he has used the narrow neck flask with swan neck type. It was like this. Louis Pasteur has used the swan neck type of flask, and what was his experiment? He has kept his nutrient medium. What was his nutrient medium? Sugar syrup and yeast extract. This was the nutrient medium which was taken by Louis Pasteur and the swan neck flask. So earlier when he kept this flask, so there was no growth of microorganisms, or there was no origin of life. When he destroyed this flask from here, so this become accessible for the flies, or this become accessible for the other organisms to let into the flask. So after some days, when he observed that, when he destroyed the neck of the flask, there was the easy access for the different microorganisms, and other life forms were also have been evolved in this flask. This was the experiment of Louis Pasteur, and his experiment is also known as swan neck flask. The fourth option was sphalanxining. It could not be the answer. Now, the next question. Experimental proof that some simple molecules like hydrogen, ammonia, methane and water gives rise to the amino acid during the origin of life was provided by. The first option is Lamarck, second one Darwin, third one Stanley Miller and Urey, and the fourth third one Stanley Miller, and the fourth one Harold Urey. So Miller and Urey, they both collectively performed the experiment, and the name of their experiment was simulation experiment. So the answer will be third and fourth, both Stanley Miller and Harold Urey. Now, next one, Earth originated in the past period about, options are 4.5 billion years ago, the second one 8.0 billion years ago, third one 3 billion years ago, fourth one 1 billion years ago. The option is 4.5 billion years ago, or it could vary from 4.4 billion years ago to 4.6 billion years ago. In some books 4.4 billion years ago is written, and in some books 4.5 or 4.6 billion years ago has also been written. So have a verified answer about the origin of life. So when you answer the question, mark the estimated one, mark the around one, that which is given around the 4.4 or 4.5 or 4.6. Now, the next question, the scientist associated with the formation of modern theory of life and having written the origin of life. As a scientist, jisne modern theory of life diya ho and has also written the book Origin of Life. We have studied earlier this. The options are Huxley, no. He has given the theory of biogenesis. Lamarck, no. He has given the theory of inheritance of acquired characters. Darwin, no. He has given the theory of natural selection. Oparin, yes, it could be. Yes, and it is the correct answer. He has worked, or he has proposed the modern theory of origin of life and also written the book Origin of Life. The next question, the first organism were chemoautotrophs. Second one, chemoheterotrophs. Third one, autotrophs. Or fourth one, eukaryotics. The first organisms. The first option, chemoautotrophs. No, these were not chemoautotrophs because chemoautotrophs were deep sulfur like bacteria. They were using the energy by fermentation and they were doing the photosynthesis like process with the help of sulfur. So these could not be the answer, and they were using the chemoautotrophic method. They were using the chemicals for the formation of their food, and they were anaerobic in they were doing the anaerobic respiration. The second one, chemoheterotrophs. Yes, the first organism were Eubacterium isolatum. They were evolved around 3.5 billion years ago, and these were the animals, or these were the organisms who were chemoheterotrophic, or who were performing the chemoheterotroph type of nutrition, and they were also anaerobic. The second one, autotrophs, no, because autotrophs are present now, that is plants and eukaryotes, no. Next question, the most primitive cell like chemical aggregates capable of the growth and the division were. Question ko dhyan se padhiye, samjhiye कि हमने इस टर्म को कहाँ पढ़ा है. क्वेश्चन में कुछ एक ऐसा टर्म दिया हुआ होगा जिससे हम डायरेक्टली क्लिक कर सकते हैं हमारे माइंड में कि हाँ, दिस कुड बी द पॉसिबल आंसर. द क्वेश्चन इज द मोस्ट प्रिमिटिव सेल लाइक केमिकल एग्रीगेट केपेबल ऑफ ग्रोथ एंड डिविजन. केमिकल एग्रीगेट, हमने कहाँ केमिकल एग्रीगेट वर्ड पढ़ा है? In the coacervates and the microspheres, that were the form of the protobionts. Protobionts are the precursors of the first life. They were not the real first life, or they were not considered as the first life or the first self, but they were only the precursors of the first life. And these protobionts were of two types, coacervates and the microspheres. Coacervates were the These were formed by carbohydrates, protein and water. When carbohydrate, protein and water, they were vigorously shaked, so some colloidal structures were formed. These were the coacervates, but they were not capable of the division. They were only performing the growth and the metabolism. They were not able to perform the some type of division. Why? Because there was no plasma membrane present. No cell membrane was present at that time. And when we talk about the microspheres, microspheres were formed by carbohydrates, proteins, lipids and water. When four these entities were heated up to 130 to 180 degrees Celsius and again cooled down, then microspheres were formed. What were the properties of these microspheres? They were showing growth, they were showing metabolism, and also they were showing cell division or some kind of division or pre-reproductive stage. So these were also the colloidal form, the carbohydrates, proteins, lipids and water. When they combined together and when they were heated up to 130 to 180 degrees Celsius and then cooled down, then the microspheres were formed, and these microspheres were able to do growth, they were able to do cell division and perform metabolism. So the answer, the options are chemoautotrophs. No, chemoautotrophs could not be the answer because chemoautotrophic animals were deep sulfur like bacteria. They were not the some kind of aggregates. They were not the chemical aggregates which were capable of growth and division. They were capable of growth and division, but they were not in the form of chemical aggregates. The second one, eubiont, no. The third one, prokaryotes, no. The fourth one, microspheres, yes. This is the chemical aggregation of carbohydrates, proteins, lipids and water. The fourth one, Russian scientist who proposed the theory of origin of life. We have looked after one question here. The Russian scientist who proposed the theory of origin of life. The first option is Oparin, second Heldin, third Miller, fourth Fox. Oparin will be the answer because he is belonging to the Russia and he is the only one who has proposed the theory of origin of life. Heldin has also proposed the theory of any origin of life, but he was not belonging to Russia. He was belonging to England and later on he got shifted to India. The third one, Miller, no, he has performed the simulation experiment. The fourth one, Sidney Fox, no, because he has given the concept of microspheres. Now, the next question. Under certain conditions, scientists have got cell-like structure, but without its true organization. They are called, the first option is eubiont, second one protist, third one coacervids, the fourth one microbes. So the answer will be, when we hum dekhte hain kaun sa answer ho sakta hai, eubiont, no, because they were showing the true organization, they were evolved after microspheres. So microspheres mein jab cell division start ho gaya tha, so eubiont mein molecular organization to start ho hi gaya hoga. Now protist, no, they were more evolved than eubiont. See, coacervids, yes, it could be the answer, because coacervids were the colloidal like structure and we have seen here that coacervids is formed by carbohydrates, proteins and waters. There is no lipids in that. So when there is no lipid, they could not perform the cell division also, and when there is no cell division, so there will be no molecular organization also. So the answer will be the coacervids. Next question, ozone layer is important as it is, first option, reduces the light reflection, second option, provides the O2 to jet filters, third option, absorb extra light rays, and the fourth option, filters out UV radiation. So the answer will be, it is pretty direct, that filters out UV radiation. It is the shield like, ozone layer is the shield like around our earth and it filters the UV radiation coming from the sun. Now the next question, choose the correct sequence during the formation of chemicals on the early environment. So the options are ammonia, water, nucleic acid, proteins. This is the first option. Ammonia, after ammonia water, after water nucleic acid, and after nucleic acid proteins. No, it could not be the answer. Then ammonia, protein, carbohydrates and nucleic acid, it could be answer because it is pretty correct. The third one, ammonia, nucleic acid, protein and carbohydrate, no, because protein was evolved earlier than nucleic acid. Fourth option, protein, carbohydrate, water and nucleic acid, no, nucleic acid were after protein and water was before the carbohydrates. So the answer will be the second one, ammonia, protein, carbohydrate and nucleic acid. The next question, first photosynthetic organism to appear on earth was, the options are bacteria, green algae, cyanobacteria and bryophytes. Cyanobacteria is the answer because cyanobacteria were the first organism who performed the photosynthesis, because true chlorophyll have been first evolved in the cyanobacteria, and these were the only organisms who performed photosynthesis and who also released oxygen in the environment, and around 2.5 billion years ago oxygenic revolution was there in the environment, and oxygen start accumulating the environment, accumulating in the environment. So cyanobacteria is the first bacteria who started photosynthesis and also released oxygen in the environment. Now the next question, Oparin's theory is based on the first one, artificial synthesis, second one, spontaneous generation, third one, God's creation, and fourth one, panspermia. So the answer will be artificial synthesis, because the spontaneous generation belonging to the abiogenesis, God's creation belongs to the theory which was proposed by Father Suarez, creation of God, and the last one, that is panspermia. This theory said that the life has arrived to the earth in the form of spores, in meteors or in some kind of spaceship. So this is not the concept of the Oparin's theory. Oparin's theory was based upon the artificial synthesis of the molecules. So the artificial synthesis will be the answer. We will continue some more questions in the next video.